A touching tribute on the cover of Boston Magazine, a heart formed by many, many running shoes worn by those who ran in the Boston Marathon. The media pendulum in the last few days has started to swing back toward the victims of the Boston bombing as journalists have sought out interviews with the wounded.
When you look at that incredible picture of him carrying you away, what goes through your mind?
God had angels watching me that day.
Do you still feel the
food? I do. Not right this second, but I do. When I have a sheet over it, I can feel that feeling of the sheet on top of your toes. I still have phantom itch, which is weird. You can't scratch it.
But television has devoted huge amounts of airtime to the lives of the Sarnaev brothers in a way that critics such as Rush Limbaugh say is too sympathetic.
Yeah, that's all it is. It's a mixed up kid, totally normal American kid out there smoking pot, watching YouTube, driving around in his Porsche, not liking America, totally normal kid. Nothing to see here. Very sad, in fact.
Jane Hull, has there not been enough on the victims, for example? We've kind of moved on from the 8-year-old boy, Martin Richard, who was killed in that attack. Mm-hmm.
Well, you know, if Martin Richard's family were giving interviews, I'm sure many people have wanted them to do that. And I don't know about that, but I know enough about TV to know that we would see that story. I think it's very important to see the victims. And you'll be surprised to hear, I actually think Rush Limbaugh has a point. To portray him as a hapless teenager, or now the frame is this is a distortion of the American dream, which is in two news stories that are out.
I don't agree
with that.
Okay, here we have very lengthy pieces, front page of the Washington Post, portrait of a faded American dream, picture of the family, the Sarnaev family there. New York Times, front page, before bombs, a battered American dream. And so Michael Medved, have the media to some extent, as they try to understand what happened to these two guys, been portraying, and particularly the 19-year-old, as a mixed-up kid?
Well, I think it's inherently dramatic, and it is a huge question, because at least the younger brother, Johar, did seem to be enjoying some success in school, et cetera, et cetera. So what goes wrong with someone like this? And this brings me back just a little bit to something that Cenk said earlier, which is, it is different because these brothers both had become radicalized and Islamic. And no, they don't represent all Muslims. And no one is saying that every single Muslim in the United States represents some kind of problem or even potential problem. But the point is, there is a context here. And the context is, there is a worldwide movement. It's a powerful worldwide movement. It's a dangerous worldwide movement. It's caused violence everywhere. And these particular brothers became part of it. The question about how they became part of it and why seems to me a absolutely legitimate field for investigation.
And Cenk, Johar Sarnaev, he's not just a teenager. Yes, it seemed to be a semi-successful college student, but he is allegedly someone who kills and maims. And I just worry that that is getting drained from some of these profiles.
Yeah, I'm surprised that people perceive that. I don't perceive that at all. I mean, he's a terrorist, and everything I've ever read, it talks about how he's a terrorist. I mean, look, you have to try to figure out their motives. Now, look, we give them too much attention on the one
hand. Do you have to try to figure out their motives, or are they just two sick and twisted individuals who may not be, even though it kind of serves the media agenda to paint it as on a larger canvas, who may not be representative of anything that is much larger than their own tendencies toward violence?
Well, we don't know until we figure out their motives. That's my point. And look, I'm a little conflicted on this because I don't want to give too much attention to people who do this, because I think some of them are doing it for the attention. When it came to the mass shooters in Newtown, for example, I've never said the guy's name, because we don't publicize streakers. We don't show them on TV. But when you shoot 26 people or you bomb and kill 4 people and injure 260, we go on and on about it. So I get that point, Howard. On the other hand, we got to know what caused it so we can prevent the next one.
And all right, that's a fair point. That's a fair point. From the Washington Post, Jane Hull, the older one, Tamerlan, was sociable, even showy, dressing sharply, honing his body to become an Olympic boxer. I don't care. I don't care whether his friends think he's cool. I just want to know about the crime, how it was committed, and I don't want us to lose the spotlight, and as I said, there's been more stories lately, interviews with the wounded, on those who were hurt by those attacks as opposed to those who carried them out.
Well, you know, I kind of share the ambivalence. On the one hand, I want to know what caused it, and on the other hand, I don't want the People magazine profile of these people. You know what I mean?
You know, there was an amazing bit of use of technology in the New York Times the other day on this, and I want to take a moment to show it. If we can put it up, the Times had a photograph of the moment with runners crossing the finish line of the Boston Marathon when that explosion took place, and was able to, through reporting, to identify each person, interview them, do audio interviews, and then we could hear their sounds, we could hear their take on what had happened, how they felt at that moment. Let's play some of that.
I said out loud, this is how my life is going to end, and blessed myself, and I said, please, God, let my children be okay, because I didn't know where they were at that.
Using technology to tell the story. Jane Hall, Cenk Uygur, and Michael Medved, thanks very much for joining us.